your camera before we can start the lecture. Can you hear me? Please turn on your camera and so we can start the lecture. Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you for turning on your mobile, your camera, sorry. Okay, we don't have any assignment due today, so we'll just we'll discuss the topic. But before that, I would like to show you some document. Sorry, not this one. No, this one. Okay. Okay. So this is the report on the acceptance test. Okay. So later we will we will learn about how to test our system before handing it over to the client or customer. So apart from the project that I was working with the Ministry of Home Affairs and also Australian government, it was actually two parts of project. First is the development of application, the MIS, Management Information System. The second is the building of data center for hosting the application, because the Ministry of Home Affairs at that time said that they don't have enough computers or servers to host and run the application, so the Australian government built them data center. Okay, so with all works that you've been doing for developing a system, when it finished, before handed over to the customer or the client, we need to have a series of tests. Okay, we will discuss the test later. But one of the tests was the acceptance test. So this is the document showing the plan for acceptance test. Okay, so this is all the. The one that I want to show you is actually this one. So there is the signature of the government official and also the signature from the developer who built the data center. So both parties witnessing this test. So, and this is the test approval, acceptance approval. These are the people who actually conducting the test. So this is the document. Yeah, you need to have something in written and also signed in written by all the stakeholders that relevant to the system. Okay. That's it. So that's among other things that formality that goes into developing a system. Now, today we will discuss the start of a project, how we would start the project, how we would actually executing the project after we have all the planning put in place. Okay, so let's start the slide. Okay, so initiating and planning system development project. Okay, so what is the process on formally executing the project? Okay, so we're still here on the planning part. Okay, because in any management process, planning is a paramount. Okay, although it might not consume a lot of time, but it's very important to be done seriously. So, project initiation focuses on activities designed to assist in organizing a team to conduct project planning. So, this is where the project manager, by the way, if you are interested in becoming a project manager, there are plenty of short courses, online courses, and also exam certification for project management. You can have the project management certification, the PMP, and also any other. Okay. Anyway, so this is project focused on activity to organizing team. Okay, so you gather all the human resources required to form a team to execute the project planning. These are the steps or phases: establishing the project initiation team, establishing relationship with the customers. Like I said previously, from time to time, regularly, either formally or informally, we need to update the customer on the status of the project. We need to keep the customer aware any problems or any obstacles that will probably will delay the development of the project, and so on and so forth. We also need to manage the customer expectation. Yeah, you know, so they don't have any wild ideas on how the project was done. Okay. This is not magic. This is just ordinary working project. Okay, so establishing project initiation plan, establishing management procedures. Okay. With projects, since you have a lot of people involved, you need to have some kind of structure in all the procedures. Like, for example, if there's any delay in one of the activities or tasks, who should be updated on that delay? How? What kind of documents required? What kind of procedure? And also other small, probably, but very important procedures like disbursing money, request for payment, things like that. Okay, so there are procedures. Experienced project manager usually will have this kind of procedures in place. You know, standard operating procedures, they just need to adjust that to the project that will be done. Okay, establishing project management environment and project workbook, and also the developing the project charter. Okay, now this is a project charter. This is what, even though it was mentioned the last, it will be discussed first. So, project charter is a short document that is prepared for both internal and external stakeholder, provides a high level overview of the project. And this is a useful communication tool that helps to assure that organization and other stakeholders understand the initiation of a project. So basically, this is to let everybody outside the project team know that there is a project or there are projects, if you like. So sometimes when you have a project, the client will provide a room or rooms that can be used for project management teams to work on, and it's exclusively for them. Nobody else could do it, could use it for the duration of the project. So you need to make aware that all the other staff understand that there is a project ongoing. Okay. You probably seen this project charter. Okay, but let me show you this. So this is part of project charter. Okay. So if you look at this, this is to inform whoever passing through this part of this Tambangan Kelekar village that there is a project. Okay, what are the project? To continue building road for the village. Okay, the value of the project, 200 million something. Okay, how long the project will it take? 90 days. Okay, and who responsible for this project? Who is the executor of the project? Which is CV Bidar Kencana Sakti. So this is a project charter. Whenever you passing through or seeing this kind of information, this is part of the project charter. This is to make aware people that there is a project happen. Okay. Sometimes it's just a piece of paper put in front of the door to a room saying that this is the room for project A, project B, or project C. Okay. So what's project charter typically contains? Project title and date of authorization. Okay, so like this one, the type of the projects, the title of the projects, who is the project manager name and contact information, unfortunately with the previous example, they don't have it, but they have the executor, customer name and contact information, project start and completion dates, okay, key stakeholders, project role and responsibilities, project objective and description, key assumption or approach, and also signature section for key stakeholders. So there should be a signature showing their approval of the project. Okay, like. And then start with process of initiating and planning IS development project. Okay, so with the project planning, the process is to define clear, discrete activities and the work needed to complete each activity within single project. You already started this with project management phases, those four phases that we discussed last week, and you also work on initial budget. So the objective of project planning is to develop a baseline project plan and project scope statement. So like this one, this is the scope of the project. This is to continue building road, not building a new one, not fixing that currently exists but broken. This is to continue building road, whatever it is. Okay. So it's clear for all the stakeholders of the project what the project will be doing. So what's the element of project planning? First, describe the project scope and alternative feasibility. Okay. Now with project scope, this has to be done in writing and also approved with signature by all the key stakeholders. Why? Because this is the first start, the first step to ensure that the project can be done in time and within budget. I've been working on this and also I published on this. There is a phenomenon in any project which is called scope creep. Scope creep means the project scope growing little by little, just small increment. Like for example, if you build a website, then somebody said, can you add this little thing, or can you change the design of this, can you change the picture, and so on and so forth. That request usually seems, at the beginning at least, seems very, very small. And it will take no time to just add that. Okay. However, if that being done repeatedly, frequently, then you will have change in scope tremendously. That's significant. And that will create problem in finishing the project in time and within budget. Why? Because the initial scope, okay, so the budget and the time was calculated based on initial scope. But since the scope growing, although the growth itself seems small, but in the end it's growth. So you have bigger scope than the initial scope. In any case, bigger scope means you need longer time and also additional resources, including money. Longer time, bigger budget. That's the basic of any project. If you want to expand the scope, you need to allocate additional time and you need to allocate additional budget. The problem is, a lot of people, especially Indonesian, having this feeling that they could say no to customer, especially when the customer are a long-time customer and they have a good relationship in the past, they couldn't say no to customer. To just small request, but if the small request happen repeatedly and frequently, then you will have bigger request. Okay, so this was the problem that happened to a lot of people. When I was teaching project management in for the Master of Informatics in Atmajaya, yeah, this is the problems that all the students in my class mentioned. So they have this. In the past, I did this too. Okay. In the past, as project manager, so I share the same thing. So, what should we do in that? If the customer asking for change in the project scope in the middle of the project, first, especially if you working as consultant or as system developer, never say no to customer request. To expand the scope, okay? Never say no. But at the same time, also don't agree immediately. Okay, so if customer asking for change in scope, the first thing you need to do is to say to the customer, I'll analyze it. So you need to go through the changes requested, make the calculation, make the estimation, see if the change request will change the scope. Okay. If it changes the scope, then you need to calculate whether this change will change the requirement, affect the schedules, and definitely affect the budget. Okay. If it's insignificant change, you can say yes, we will do it with no additional money, with no additional time. Easy peasy. However, if the request was significant in changing scope, and therefore it will change the time and also the budget, you need to calculate the change and present it to the client. If the client agreed, it means you will have additional work, you will have additional revenue, which is good. That's why I said earlier that don't immediately reject or accept. Okay, think about it. If it's significant, change the budget, change the timeline, then you will have additional work, you will have additional revenue, which is good. Okay. If the customer see that the time, additional time and budget is beyond their scope, usually they will back out and return to the original scope. Okay, this is where negotiation comes in. So again, example from the Ministry of Aware, the outside project that I mentioned to you earlier. PNPM program is not done by the government itself. Okay, the government overseeing, but the executor was private companies hired by government, because industry government doesn't have the money, doesn't have the resources to execute the project. So they hire private companies. That's the private companies called the RM, regional something. I can't remember what RM means. So basically, there were six companies that executing or managing. Oh, RM is regional manager. So the six companies manage the PNPM program throughout all over Indonesia. Okay, so there were six. However, and we worked with those six companies initially to develop the design. However, when we are in the middle of development, creating the application, those six companies contract were run out and they were replaced by new six companies. Okay, so when we present our design to the new six companies, they were asking a lot of changes. Okay, we had 3 days workshop in Bandung, okay, to discuss that. So we invited a representative from those six companies, and also representative from World Bank, and also representative from the Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay, so we discussed that, and those six companies that managing the PNPM program all over Indonesia, sorry, asking for a lot of change. Okay, so the developer return after the workshop, calculating the changes, and then they present that to USAID and also Ministry of Home Affairs. Apparently, all the changes requested by the six companies that managing this PNPM will add about 5 billion to the budget, 5 billion rupiah, and also additional 6 months to complete. People from Ministry of Affairs were shocked, to put it mildly. So, and also outside. So what happened was they going through all the requested changes, and then they have to drop about 45% of the changes. So the scope change happened, but only about half of the original requests. Okay, so you don't immediately say no, you don't immediately say yes, analyze the request, see if it's impacted the time and money or budget to complete the project. If it's yes, present it. Okay, so after the client with agreed to the change in time and budget, they need to sign new contract. They need to sign new project charter. So the old project charter said that the project will finish in a year, 12 months, for example. But since there are changes, the project now will complete it in 14 months. So additional 2 months. So this additional need to be put into contract. So the old chapter will be discarded, will be abandoned, and we have new charter. The budget from initially 1 billion, for example, because the additional work, it will now cost 1.1 billion. That's fine. Put that in writing and have all the stakeholders sign that off. With this way, you don't lose jobs. You get additional jobs, in fact. You get additional revenue. And also you keep your reputation as developer intact because you will never leave. A lot of projects in the world fail because the scope changed in the middle of the project and the project manager failed to get agreement in writing to change the project scope. Okay. Divide project into tasks, we will do this later. Estimate resource requirement and create resource plan because a lot of people, a lot of companies having limited resources. For example, if you develop a project, application or information system, you will need programmer, you will need a tester to test the software, you will need a technical report, things like that. However, during the development of the application, during the coding part, you don't need tester. The tester will come later. So you don't make schedule or resource plan for tester early. You make that for later. Okay. And also programmer. During the planning, you probably don't need a lot of programmers. So schedule them for later. Okay. The preliminary communication plan. Communication plan, what kind of document information can be given to customers or any other stakeholders who should sign on the communication. Okay. You look at the situation. Nobody can say anything to the outside parties. Okay. Any big organization, any big companies, they will have a public relation office that will deliver the message to the public. Even with the government, okay, the government, they have the speaker for or press secretary or something like that to deliver the message to the public. Okay, so determine standards and procedures, identify and assess risks, create preliminary budget, develop a statement of work, and set baseline project plan. Okay, so what's the case, business case is a justification for information system. This is to justify why we need this new information system. Why? And also include in the business case is all the feasibility study that has been done so that the project would be feasible. Okay. Obviously, the first thing that we need to show is the economic feasibility. Benefit should be bigger than the cost. And then we will show the technical and organizational feasibility. Okay. We should show why we choose this particular technology, why not the others. For examples, if you want to equip your staff with mobile phone, which one? What kind of platform? Okay. Why did you select those platform? Things like that. Another deliverable baseline project plan. This is some kind of the best estimate of project scope, benefit, cost, risk, and resource requirement. You actually developing this now. With that last week, we already have the four phases of project management, and currently you are working on budget. Project scope statement, okay, document, prepare for customer, describe what the project will deliver, outlines high level, all works required to complete the project. Project feasibility, we already discussed this in accounting information system, but we'll go through this briefly. Economic, obviously, benefit should exceed the cost. How much exceeding? It depends on the company and also the project. Technical, do we have the technology to do it? Do we have the expertise to do it? Okay. Operational, can it be done without disrupting the organizational operation? Okay. Scheduling, can it be done on time? Legal and contractual, is there any issue with legality, like probably software license, hardware license, using others' intellectual property right? Political. Okay, so this is actually a very interesting example. When I was brought in as the quality assurance consultant for that project with Ministry of Affairs, one problem with that they faced was the difference between World Bank and Ministry of Home Affairs. People at Ministry of Home Affairs at that time, they were sponsoring Undang-Undang Desa. Okay, so the government at that time, Pak SBY actually trying to create Undang-Undang Desa. And it was in the middle of the process to become undang-undang, to become the law, the act. So, because of its village level, Ministry of Home Affairs want the details of the information system come to the village level. However, the original PNPM doesn't cover village. They only go through sub-district, kecamatan. So World Bank insists that the data only goes to detail up to sub-district or kecamatan level, while the Ministry of Affairs want to have village level because they were anticipating Undang-Undang Desa. Okay. And they could not meet in the middle, they could not achieve agreement, they could not compromise on that. So what we did was, because it's political, was to have the system up to the detail levels of village. However, we will lock that for the time being. So until the Undang-Undang Desa becoming a law, we will disable the village module. So the user of the system could only access the sub-district or kecamatan module. Okay. Later, when we have the at that time, when we had the Undang-Undang Desa, then the village module can be activated. So this is some report on project disability. Okay. This is economic disability. Okay. The problem with information system usually is the benefit, especially intangible benefit. With tangible benefit, it's easy. Reduce personal expenses, lower transaction costs, higher profit margin, for example. Now, obviously, we will have lower costs in doing online classes because we don't have actually have a physical classroom. Okay, but is there any other intangible things that will either cost or benefit about that? Okay, so typically tangible benefit will fall into this category: cost reduction or cost avoidance, error reduction, increased flexibility, sorry, increased speed of activity, improvement of management planning and control, opening new market, and increasing sales opportunities. This is the intangible benefit. This is the most difficult part to measure. You know it, that it's there, you know it's happening, you know it's influencing the organization, but it's very hard to quantify. And if it's hard to quantify, it's very difficult to compare it to the cost, which usually very easy to quantify. Okay. Improvement of morale. Okay. Reduction of waste, it's good, all good, and it's true, it's realistic, but very hard to quantify it. People cost, hardware cost, labor cost, operational cost, and so on and so forth. Intangible costs, employee morale, operational inefficiency, especially at the beginning when people learning how to use the new system. loss of customer goodwill. When I was working with PhotographerNet, there is one problem. The version that I did was criticized because it's more complicated. Okay. It's more complicated because the user asking for it. Unfortunately, at the time, the management of PhotographerNet want to satisfy a lot of people, so they create a list of features that demanded by users, and we as the developer have to deliver them, and we did, we delivered them. Unfortunately, in any information system, more functionality, more features means more computing powers required, and that's creating a problem with a limited hardware. So what happened was the application become a little bit slower compared to the previous version, and a lot of people complain about it. Okay. Customer goodwill. Okay, so what are the type of costs? One-time costs, especially for purchasing hardware, software, training, site preparation, conversion, and also recurring costs, application software maintenance. Remember when we discussed the source of software, I talked about license. There's perpetual license that you bought that once, and that's it. After that, you have the software as long as you like. And there is annual license that you have to pay every year to have the software use. Okay. Now with cloud, if you considering using cloud, one-time cost usually associated with fixed costs. Okay, while recurring costs usually associated with variable costs. With cloud system, this one become, especially hardware and software, become recurring costs. Okay, so in the old days, when you want to have this application that our system that quite big, you need to buy servers, and servers are not cheap. In 10 years ago, no brand server that you know can handle work like PhotographerNet cost $25 million. That's no brand server. Okay. And at the time, I had to buy 10 of them, so a quarter of billion rupiah, which is quite big for small company. But with cloud now, it's easy. Okay, buying servers is hard. Why? Because there is nobody have server lying around ready to be sold. When you purchase a server, you place an order to the supplier, and then supplier will build the server for you. So it's make to build. Okay. I'll be happy if I can get the server that I want ready to be used in 6 months. So from the initial purchase until you can use it, it took about 6 months on average. With cloud, just go to Amazon, go to Microsoft Azure, or go to Google Cloud, click how many servers you like, type of servers you like, capacity, the performance, so on and so forth, pay that, that's it. In Amazon Web Service, in my experience, from the payment to the servers being ready to be used is just about 5 minutes or less. Okay, so 5 minutes. That's quite fast compared to 6 months. Okay. So with the use of cloud, a lot of fixed costs currently become variable costs, and it's much more flexible. So you want additional servers? In the old days, you have to buy servers 6 months. With cloud, additional servers easy peasy. Just click, pay, that's it. You in 5 minutes you get new servers. Okay. With cost, there will be procurement, acquiring everything that you need. The startup costs, project-related costs, and operating costs. Okay. this is the financial technique to determine financial or economic feasibility. I will not cover this. It's already being discussed thoroughly in any other subject. Okay, then the process of assessing the development organization ability to construct a proposed system. Okay. Now the risk factor. There are few risk factor for a project. First is the project size. The bigger the project, the bigger the risk. Project structure. If you build something completely new, it's much more riskier than just improving the current one. Development group, if you build a Android application and with people who have never learned Android, it will be riskier compared to if you use seasonal or experienced Android developer. User group, how familiar users with a system development process. If it's when we develop the MIS for Ministry of Home Affairs, because it will be used all over Indonesia, and to be honest, a lot of people that will use the system have different educational background. Some of them have a undergraduate degree, some of them might not even finish high school. So what should we do? So when the survey was conducted and we saw a lot of people, met a lot of people all over Indonesia, we saw that there is one thing in common at that time. This was 2011, which was Facebook. A lot of people able to use Facebook, and they are quite good at it. You know, uploading video, uploading picture, posting comment, things like poke, and so on and so forth, playing games in Facebook. So we use Facebook as the minimum easiness to use the system. It should be as easy as using Facebook. If that can be done, then we don't need to worry about a lot of training and so on. Okay, so we use Facebook as the model to be, for the system that can be used easily. Okay. And risk can be managed by changing project plan. This will go later perhaps, but if you are aware, in Indonesia there are plenty of public holiday. Okay, and that's only for a national public holiday. If you go to Bali, for example, that's another story. In Bali, Hindus, resident of Bali, usually associated with their local pura or temple. Okay. And each temple or pura, they have their own schedules on celebrating something. And usually, if pura had this celebration, all the member of that pura will have day off. Okay. It means, apart from national holiday, in Bali you will have local or regional holiday, where people could not go to work because they have to celebrate or participating in religious ceremony in their pura. Okay, so it's very hard in Bali, for example, to have complete staff all the time. This day probably A will be absent because of celebration in his pura. Tomorrow, Bee will be absent because celebration in her borough. And that's normal. That's not something that, what do you say, what's the right word? It's just a daily life in Bali. If you're working in Bali and if you employ Balinese resident, then that's what the problem that you have to face. Okay. We could not prohibit them to participate in celebration or religious ceremony because that's their human rights. Okay. But we can manage that by allocating resources. Okay, or additional resources. Okay. Assigning project team members to carefully manage this. I'm sorry, it's probably not, but for female employees, especially female employees who were expecting, we need to calculate that also. Okay. As long as the female employees staff could work before giving birth, that's fine. But after giving birth, we need to give them time, maternity leaves. Okay, and that's a fact of life. We should give the female employees their rights, but also we need to think about the continuation of the project. So we need to prepare for that. Okay, and that's actually varied between countries because some countries have maternity and paternity leave, for example. In Denmark, if a mother giving birth, the father could also apply for paternity leave because the father will also take care of the baby. Okay. In Belgium, if I'm not mistaken, if a female employee giving birth, she could, well, it's not actually resign, but take indefinite leave. Okay, so she could take care of the baby, and then when the baby is big enough to be put into childcare, then the mother could return to the old job, and the company have to give her her old job, although probably not exact job, but the same rank, the same pay grade, and probably similar responsibility. Not promote them, not demote them, but put them on their original position before they leave for maternity. Okay, so that's in Belgium. In Indonesia, female employee who give birth, they get 3 months maternity leave. Some company also give extra. So you need to be aware of this kind of regulation. Okay. So, setting up monitor methods. Okay. You need to really, really understand what happened with the project, how to know the progress, what kind of report need to be done, things like that. Okay, so project size, project structure, development group, and the user groups. We already have this. Larger project are riskier than smaller project. Okay, if you understand requirement, highly structured and easily understand requirement, it's less riskier than if you go to new projects. Okay, if you use well-known development methodology, it will be less riskier than compared to if you use new methods. Okay, and also if you have a familiar user group, it will be less riskier than if you have unfamiliar user group. Okay, so this is the matrix. So this is how addressability. We already did that. So this is the baseline project plan, the layout, introduction, you have system description, system description, you have feasibility assessment, and also management issue. Okay. So now, the scope. What determining the scope? First, you need to see which organizational unit affected by the new system. Will the customer affected by the new system? Will the supplier affected by the new system? Will other department affected by the new system? Okay. Current system that will interact with the change because of new system. For example, in any bank, okay, if you go to bank, okay, you probably have this, you probably have internet banking. You have internet banking here, you have mobile banking here, you have ATM machine here, and you have any other, you know, EDC, the machine that you swipe. And you will have what it called as core banking here. Okay. So if you change this internet banking or mobile banking or ATM, it just affect a segment of a customer that use this. Okay. So if you change internet banking, it will not affect customer who use ATM. It will not affect customer who use mobile banking. But if you change the core banking system, it will affect everybody, including the teller. Okay. So that's the scope. Okay. People who affected range of potential system capabilities thing. So if you remember, we often draw context diagram. This actually showing the system itself and any other external parties that will be affected by this system. So if you change this, suppliers, engineering, and production will be affected. Okay. So this is that's our lecture today. Any question so far? Okay, if there is nothing to inquire, I think that's it for today. Okay, if you have any question about the assignment, please let me know using Microsoft Teams chat or send me email, and I'll try to answer your question as soon as possible. Okay, so that's it for today. Have a good day and see you next week.